Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hayyakum Allah. Welcome, Dr. Abdul Haq Baker. And first and foremost, it's a pleasure to host you and for you to share some of your life experience and a little bit about your journey to Islam and really any knowledge or any advice you want to impart to the youth. And, you know, just give us an idea about your journey. You know, it's a pleasure, and I'm so glad we had this opportunity to finally get together. And hopefully this is just the beginning. Hopefully this is just the tip of the iceberg that we can actually do some other projects in the future. So, yeah, please, without further ado, share your experience, background, journey, maybe up to the work you do, and any advice for the youth.
Jazakallah khair. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First and foremost, I want to say, Khalid, as I mentioned to you, this is the first time we're actually seeing and speaking to each other in the flesh, right? So you could say a cyberspace.
Yeah. Like. Yeah, right.
I want to say, as I've said to you in our communications previously, Jazakallah khair, and I'm very proud in the halal way that seeing another Salafi obtaining a PhD. Okay, in studies that are focusing on our belief system, on what we are and who we are, so that we can speak as an authority from an insider perspective, because we know there's a plethora of academics, Muslim and non-Muslim, who are outside of this understanding of Salafia, speaking about our reality. So I want to say to you here on record, Jazakallah khair, because when I had finished my PhD over 10 years ago, I was looking around on the horizons to say, where are our brothers? Where are our sisters? And I'm sure there are others, but you're the only other one that I know of to date, mashallah.
Jazakallah khair. Allah you barak fik.
About myself, Brother Khalid, alhamdulillah, I came to Islam, it's 30 years ago now, mashallah, tabarakallah. And that was in March of 1990. Now, the preceding year, a lot of seismic changes were taking place across the world, mashallah, tabarakallah. On a personal perspective, my wife had just had my first child, mashallah, my first daughter, alhamdulillah. And we were going through, my friends and I were going through a process of introspection and reflection. Now, as friends, as you know, with black and white colleagues in our day, you're called a gang these days. So I refer to my gang. It was just black and white individuals, predominantly black. Okay. But we were quite conscious and intellectual. Mm. And before I came to Islam, we had gone on a spiritual and journey. And a lot of that was musical. As you know, black people, music is intrinsic to us from our parents and everything like this. Yes. And even right back down, emanating from slavery. And my father was Nigerian, African. And he passed away in 2009, just as I was finishing my PhD. My mother is still alive, mashallah, tabarakallah. She's Guyanese. Let I be clear, because many people can mistake, especially Europeans. Ghana and Guyana are two different places. Yes. Ghana is Africa, as you well know. My mother is from Guyana, South America.
Yes.
So for me, alhamdulillah, that cross-cultural sort of upbringing gave me particular perspective as well as I was growing up. That as a black individual, plus being taken out of an urban environment, educational environment, into a predominantly white environment, I was the only black individual in my class, gave me yet another paradigm, which I realize as I've grown has led to me being as I am now, the different perspectives that I have, the ease with which I can engage and fraternize and communicate with others, mashallah. And the same for my gang, if you like, my friends. We were looking and embarking upon rap music, just like mostly everyone when we were coming to just before the 90s. I'd formed the jazz band when I was 15, 16 years old. Two of the individuals, white individuals, are now, one was white, he's now one of the top jazz pianists in the world, has been for a number of years. So we were into that sort of thing. We were into innovation and creativity and everything like that. But the backdrop to that was violence, drugs, criminality. All of that was the backdrop in which we navigated. And I thank my mum, because while she gave me free rein to do what I want, she doesn't know everything I got up to.
Yeah.
She gave us that security in our home, and having that home always to go back to when I'd be in Corsica or I'd be in south of France and I'd ring her. I'm in this part of the country. I'm this part of Europe. I'm this part. I always had a home to come back to, and that gave me a foundation. Mm. Also having my friends as a core unit to always come back to, who were always there for me and I was always there for them. Yeah. That solidarity carried through into when we were to embrace Islam over the year of 1990 together. Now, at the time of embracing Islam, what was interesting is that the 1989 was quite tumultuous, as I mentioned, on a personal level as well, because we had been attacked by police at Carnival. I've spoken about this in other instances, and that's why the George Floyd arrest really triggered some trauma for me personally, because seeing him having the neck on his neck down and the boot, the knee on his neck, I had the boot on my face, and the officers, at least eight of them on me, my friends were being arrested all around me because they saved my life, actually, because had they not stepped in and intervened after we were coming back from Carnival, my neck would have been broken. They saw this. They jumped in and a fight ensued with the police. And I want to make this point here. All of this mobile phone camera filming and everything is all well and good. And we didn't have that social technology and media at that time. But what's happening with us that we're now, a lot of us are bystanders.
Mm.
Because had my friends not jumped in, I may not be here to tell this tale now. And when I'm seeing these events around, I'm asking myself, we were never like that. I most willingly give someone else the mobile phone, and so would my peeps, and say, you know what, we're going to do jail for this, and we're in, even if it means to save a life. Whether that individual who's being treated in that way is white, black, or brown, the brutality of the police and this force being used, is violence being perpetrated against innocent bystanders, should be stopped, not just recorded. It should be stopped. So anyway, I had that pending as I came to embrace Islam. I didn't know I was going to embrace Islam, but when I went to trial and was sentenced, I was given a prison sentence, then the judge eventually suspended it. He held me to be the ringleader of a gang because I worked in the legal profession, and how dare you, it was an affront to him that here's this black guy working in the legal profession, got his own caseload, his boss, who's a quintessential British individual, comes and gives a representation saying what a good individual I am, how I am an upstanding member of white society, a black man being in white society in the legal profession. This was an affront to the judge. And he said, you're a nasty bit of work, Mr. Baker.
Yeah.
And he told the clerk, I want to adjourn the case because I want to go and play golf. But adjourn the case and for me to come back because I want to sentence this young man. Wow. He'd already sentenced my friends on that day, but he adjourned me to later on. And as I said, a month later, I was given a suspended sentence, fine and compensation to pay for the officer that I was supposed to have inflicted violence upon.
Wow.
So this was a key point for me. I've become Muslim. My career, my family life, my daughter who had now been born, all of this was up in the air, and I was going to become another statistic and another black criminal jeopardized with my career ruined. I just bought with my wife our second home as well. We were homeowners as well. So we were prosperous. We were moving forward in this way. I appealed the trial. And the interesting thing about the trial, and then I will get on, this is a platform upon which I want to talk about becoming Muslim and moving forward as a Muslim, mashallah. And during that trial, alhamdulillah, what happened is I managed to get in touch with the priest of our local church. When we were younger, and we used to go to Sunday school and choir and trying to be good boys and everything. Okay. And he was now an archdeacon in a different part of the country. And he agreed. He hadn't seen me for 15 years maybe. Right. And he agreed to become a witness for me, a character witness. And he came to my appeal. I appealed my sentence. And at that trial, the prosecution or the defense for the police, who I was now suing and saying, or in my appeal, saying I'm against the case. They asked him, do you know that he's a Muslim now? Can you see Archdeacon Fralin? Do you know that this man, Anthony Baker, is a Muslim? Like this clash of civilizations.
Yeah,
And his response was decisive. His face went red, looked at them in rage, and he said, how dare you bring religion to try and divide me from this individual. Mm. I'm going to speak about his character, regardless of what faith he has embraced. Wow. And I know him to be upstanding, decent, everything to the end. And the judge, I looked up and I saw the judge sort of nodding because that was decisive for him, that this archdeacon, head of church, is speaking in this way about this black young man here. The archdeacon knew I had a street culture. He knew that I wasn't all squeaky clean, but he knew the integrity that was actually there within me. So the judge agreed, and they agreed. They said the police had fabricated their case against me, false imprisonment, violence, everything. And the case was thrown out, and I won my case. Alhamdulillah. And Allah blessed me that I sued them. Of course, I'm going to sue them after this. And with the finances, I've never shared this before. Once I'd got my compensation, mashallah, part of that, I wanted to be grateful to Allah. So I called one of my friends who was arrested with me and our wife, some of our young kids, and said, right, let's go on Umrah. And so we came out on Umrah, mashallah, around 1992. Wow. So now, moving into when I was as Muslim, Khalid, I think one thing needs to be made really clear, because as you know, there are some cultish narratives that are trying to rewrite the history of Salafia in the West.
Okay.
And I want to state categorically for the record, when I embraced Islam and my colleagues, as a number of us, as I've mentioned, we embraced Islam in 1990, we embraced Salafia. At the hands of an American, Sirat Abdul Malik, rahimahullah. Okay. And Sirat taught us, and Sheikh Suleiman Abdul Sabor, who's from Dominica, British Dominican, he gave me my name. He's my mentor still to this day, mashallah, tabarakallah. And we were learning then, we had classes on Sundays, and I believe it was Mondays and Wednesdays, all Wednesdays, but definitely Sundays. So we were learning about the prayer.
Yeah.
We were learning the salat, the surahs, and the short surahs. And as you know from my Chronicles of Salafism, I refer to all of those notes, which I still have in my shelves from those days. They are precious to me, mashallah, tabarakallah. And we were hearing and reading the works of Sheikh Al-Albani, Sheikh bin Baz, Sheikh Uthaymin, Sheikh Muqbil. Now, we were hearing Sheikh, and the importance. Obviously, we've come to Islam. We had no respect for no authority figure in Jahiliyyah. None. Coming from a broken home after my mum and dad divorced, as you know, as black young men, no one can father us. No one can put dominion or order over us. And that's one of the reasons, because black personalities are very strong and resilient and very independent. And we don't accept authority very, very easily.
Yeah.
That's problematic in some respects, which I hope to touch upon. But coming into Islam now, hearing about shuyukh, hearing about scholarly references, and that brought a love to us, because we were being directed to hadith, explanation of hadith, ayat of Quran. I remember sitting opening Sahih Muslim, and the first hadith I'm reading is that you will see Allah like you see the full moon. And I remember sitting there looking at my friends, can you see this? We're being told we're going to see Allah in the Akhirah. And remember, we've come from a street culture. We've come from, it's like, we will see God. We're going to see Allah if we get to Jannah. And this became a driving force, and even to this day. And the point I'll make at this point, I'd like to say at this stage as a tangent, the whole reason we are doing what we are doing, the whole reason why we are upon what we're upon, Brother Khalid, I think me and you, I want to see him for whom I'm doing all of this in this life. I want to see my Lord for who all of this is being done in this life. Bottom line. Inshallah.
Yes.
And then in incorporated in that is the Anbiya and the Sahaba and the great leaders and our family, inshallah, the Muslims of them who have proceeded and those who get there, inshallah. So for us now, coming back to the point, we were learning Salafia from day one. We were learning about the ulama from day one. So when we've got these elements, cultish elements, that are saying and trying to brownwash history, because it's not whitewash, that's white supremacist, imperial systemic white society. I'm talking within the predominant South Asian Arab culture of the UK and the West, which is where the Muslims proliferate mostly. Brownwashing history by trying to say Salafia started when we came, me and them, is nothing short of a lie and a fallacy. And it's important for viewers to understand that. I came in 1990. A number of you came before that. As we were learning about Salafia, we were learning about American brothers who'd been on, and sisters who'd been upon Salafia before us, a decade before, 5 years before. And so they were coming to share what they knew about Salafia and Manhaj as well. Let's talk not just Aqidah, but Manhaj with us. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. And this was a very, Salafia continues to be a very empowering, theological powerhouse.
Yeah,
because of that reference to authenticity. And this was one of the things that I think that many of us held on to, because prior to Islam, you heard so many spurious claims. There were so many false prophets and claimants bringing fabricated narrations to try and convince people so that they could be followed. So to come and see that here is the methodology and the methodological approach to determine authenticity. By 1993, I was writing notes and learning from Abu Talha's handwritten notes on Ilm al-Mustalah Hadith, science of Hadith. And my question is, how come when we were learning those rudimentary points in 1993, why weren't we running around doing jahwa ta'dil of other people and using these slogans and these terminologies to disparage others? Why weren't we doing that? Because the teachings that we were getting for people who knew better than us, people who knew more than us. This is very, very important. When we start teaching each other, which never happened amongst my cohort, never happened in Brixton. We never taught each other as though we had that ilm. We always sought the one who was a degree above us or those who were much higher in degree, and we took knowledge from them. So we had, coming into our community, Sheikh Ahmed Dahir Awais. Somali Sheikh, student of Sheikh Rabi. Sheikh Rabi attested to that in my own home. And he told some of the cult members who were there at the time, in his own home, sorry, and when he used to live in Makkah, you must go and study with Sheikh Ahmed Dahir Awais. He was a student of mine.
SubhanAllah.
Okay, so this is who we were learning from. We were getting instruction from Sheikh Al-Albani via his students, because we would send questions back to Sheikh Al-Albani, mashallah, tabarakallah. So I think it's important that I show the premise of our learning, because there are those who are in denial, thinking that the cult narrative is the narrative for Salafia in the West. And I don't want to stick with the cult, but it's necessary to give that disclaimer so that individuals know that how Salafia and aspects of Salafia have become bastardized by these people distorting realities and bringing new codifications and calling it Salafia. New codifications, Musafika and Sa'ifika, and these codifications, and they've got a handful of the Shuyukh who are involved in that there. And when we go back 10, 20, 30 years, this was not the focus of Salafia in that instance. So now, 1994, we had some upheaval in the Brixton community. Brixton Mosque, mashallah, tabarakallah, it's a convert-led community. I respect our elders because they had become fed up with the racism that they'd been experiencing in the wider communities, the South Asian communities, the Arab communities. So they've taken over an old building in Brixton, which is now Brixton Mosque, cleaned it up, told the local council, this is going to become a mosque, got rid of the drug users that were in there, told everyone else, they run the people out of there, and they established it as a mosque, mashallah, tabarakallah. By 1994, when there was turmoil, because we'd ousted the Murabitun, who made themselves very, very clear. Their initial shura didn't say they were Sufi or anything like that. And I became part of that. They asked me to become a part of it. They saw me as one of the, if you want for want of a better phrase, one of the leaders amongst the youth. My friends would come to the religion. I was working in the legal profession. They'd see me every Jummah with my shirt, suit and tie. They say he's quite well spoken. I'd give announcements after Jummah. They said to join the Shura as part of the youth. I was 24 years old at the time. But when they declared themselves to be Murabitun, and I want to share what happened on that instance. The Uthman Morrison, who's with Murabitun in Norwich now, North England, they were professionals. They were academics and professionals and businessmen. And credit to them, they started the first Muslim housing association in South London, Ash-Shahada, which was amazing, an amazing achievement, mashallah, tabarakallah. So they said, we're going to go out to Wells, University of Wells. We're going to have a brainstorming session, brainstorm on looking at strategies for the community and everything like that. So a group of us went out there And it was quite an empowering weekend. It was really professional, really structured. And I was like, yeah, this is what management meetings should look like. Then we returned to Brixton to show what the five-year plan is going to be and everything. And so we were all excited. This is positive. But what did they do? They went to the front. I remember this clearly. And we were sitting there waiting for them to make the announcement of this is what we strategized. This is what we did. And they announced we are the Marabitun and you have to give bay'ah. Wow. To Morrison, and there's me part of the shura sitting like, wow, a celebrity, like, what is going on here? So there was uproar, there was absolute uproar, and bay'ah we knew was a bid'ah and everything like this. And so basically that was the beginning of the end for them. They were ousted by 1993, which was called Black Sunday, which is Abdul Haq Kufi has written about that in his refutation of Yusuf Bowers, A Call from the Towers. He's done a 100-page document on that. So that articulates everything, even with excerpts of and transcripts of audio recordings. Wow. So that's when we decided, those of us who had been nominated and selected from the community to go and decide on Emir, there's about seven of us, and we nominated in the end Abu Sufyan, Abdul Karim McDowell. So that heralded it in 1993, Salafi leadership in Brixton.
Okay.
And Salafi leadership of any masajid across the UK. MashaAllah, tabarakallah.
Wow.
That was short-lived. It only lasted about 10 months because Abu Sufyan was quite divisive in the way he was dealing with people in the community, even sisters. And there were some elements, I would say, of excessiveness where he got sisters to start standing at the door. And if some of the more traditional African sisters would come and they weren't wearing the head wrap properly, they'd be prevented from coming in or told they had to dress properly. Right. Shoes that weren't being put properly on the shelves were being thrown outside. And this was very divisive, very divisive.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So what happened, even for myself, my brothers, we were all part of the leadership with Abu Sufyan and Ishura, but I withdrew because for me, this was not the way to deal with the community. Mm. And I stopped going to Jummah, I stayed locally. And then we became aware of an arbitration process that was taking place. And I remember being called.
Mm.
When I was called, I didn't know what it was for, but I was worried. I was thinking, what's happening?
Yeah.
So I was then called. I came upstairs into the masjid, and in the rooms, Abu Sufyan was sitting there on his own. And he said to me, if you want, take the leadership. I said, I don't want the leadership. I didn't know what was going on. Then I was called into, which was ordinarily the sisters section, but it was empty that day.
Yeah.
And there were three arbitrators there. And one of them was Professor Noinbi from the Nigerian mosque. Okay. The other one was Feroz Gayani, Abu Umar, who's now in Riyadh. He's a graduate from Medina. Sure. And there was also Usama. I can't remember his name. He was Arab from Al-Muntada. And the community had agreed that they would be arbitrators to listen to everyone and to help with the process of turmoil that was now there and the crisis that had happened with people not wanting Abu Sufyan either. I sat down. They said to me, Abdul Haq, the community has nominated you to be the chairman. I was like, no. There's no way I'm doing that. They said, the non-Salafi community have chosen you. I said, but I'm Salafi. Like the other said, I know. But they've said, you are from the community and you have empathy for the community. They want you to lead.
Yeah.
I said, you're putting a gun to my head, metaphorically speaking. They said, yes. Yeah. And this was on the 11th, Sunday, the 11th of January, 1994.
Okay.
And I remember that they'd gathered the community to say a decision was going to be made. So after Salah, the community was sitting there in the main prayer hall. And they said, if you don't take this position, there's likely to be bloodshed and pandemonium if you don't take the position. That's why I said, you're putting a gun to my head. So I came out of the room, went into another room. The Salafi brothers heard this and they all were coming to me. Leave. And this is a thing that I learned from then about splitting Hizbiyah and the like. Brothers, my own brothers were coming and saying, Abdul Haq, leave them, because they felt an affront. They felt that they were being insulted. You've rejected Abu Sufyan's leadership. That means you've rejected our shura, because they were saying, I need to form a new shura.
Yeah.
Leave them, Abdul Haq. Let's go and set up down the road. Let's go and set up elsewhere. Let's go and do. And mashallah, tabarakallah, Sirat Abdul Malik, rahimahullah, he took me out of the room and he said to me, Abdul Haq, let's show the community what Salafiyya really is. And when he said that to me, I felt a tranquility come. I was still very nervous, but I said, I want to speak to some scholars. So at the time, they rang Muhammad Ismail from Egypt.
Okay.
And I know some of our Salafi brothers said, we won't accept any decision unless it comes from Sheikh Al-Albani himself. Mm. So mashallah, barakallah, some brothers called and spoke to the Jordanian Mashaykh, explained the situation to them. And it was like, if this is how you can establish and lead with and bring in Salafiyah properly into the community, go ahead. Mm. Alhamdulillah, this heralded in a period of growth, not because of me. The brothers came back. They formed part of my shura. And as you know and may have heard, the golden days started flourishing with Salafiyah in Brixton. The Jordanian Mashaykh come in, Yemeni Shiuk come in, Saudi Mashaykh come in, and then Abu Usama joined us, was teaching many classes, graduates from Medina for us. So these were really good periods of time, and I still got over 600 cassettes which show the lessons that were actually being taught, mashallah, tabarakallah. So for me, Khalid, moving through that particular era, as a leader of a community, and some changes had to be made. I told, spoke to Sheikh Suhaib Hassan and got advice from him, because they used to call the leader the Amir. And some said to me, you are our Amir, we will do anything you want. And I mean, literally, if it meant killing whatever, as the community was had that propensity. So I changed the title, because I said, not Imam, because I'm not an Imam. I'm not a student of knowledge. So I said, we'll use the term chairman. And that that title was stuck since that time, which represents the chairman of a charitable trust, chairman of the community, the leadership position of the community, mashallah, tabarakallah. And as you know, the return to ILM conferences started, and the team I had and the brothers who were around me, we were working in uniformity. I had the element who came from the street, like I did, the younger element and the older ones that I grew with. And then we had another more educated, I'm not saying my street lot weren't educated, they were, but they were also educated in the street life, as you know.
Right.
These others were more middle class, I won't say bourgeois, but academic middle class. And so this brought a nice synergy to the work that we were doing. And I think that's where the community started flourishing. When those cracks started appearing, those fissures started appearing in the noughties, post 2001 and everything, they got wider and wider and wider, and have never been able to come back together since then, for many, many reasons. So some will say I contributed to them because of my style of leadership. I will accept and acknowledge that to some extent. There's some decisions had to be made where no one was making decisions, and this is the direction that actually moved. So I've touched upon and gone through the 90s as a Muslim. And is there anything you want to ask about that before I move to the next decade, if you like?
No, go ahead. Tell us about your journey. Tell us about your experiences.
Jazakallah khair. So as we were, by the 90s, we were grounded in Salafiyah, Manhaj, our attachment to the scholars, everything like that, mashallah, tabarakallah. And we've been warning on our minbars for that decade against extremism, against the Kharijites, the Khawarij, the Takfiris. So when 9/11 happened, it was a shock at the mere scale of what had happened. And the first khutbah that I gave, it was very interesting. Now, I'll talk about 9/11 itself. It was on a Tuesday. My daughter had just started school, if I remember rightly, in secondary school. And I remember being at work. I worked for the Department of Education, and I was part of the IT department, National Grid for Learning. It was a flagship thing. I was a deputy project manager and became project manager of a £15 million scheme. Oh, wow. So I remember on the computer now, we were getting news of this happening. And one of the non-Muslim individuals there's me and my thobe working away, and he said, the Twin Towers have been hit by a plane. And he said, bemusedly, he said, this is like something out of King Kong and Godzilla. I'll never forget that.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, what's he talking about? Then we were hearing of more panic happening in America. So they wheeled in the TV from the conference room. And I remember standing there watching, and we saw the second plane go in.
Wow.
And I remember ringing my wife and saying, can you get my father-in-law, can you get him to get our daughter from school? Can you make sure everyone's home, that everyone's safe and everything? And we watched all of this unfold. By the end of the day now, I remember I went downstairs I was getting ready to go. Some of my work colleagues were very scared. The women went home crying, everything like that. We watched the building start, the Twin Towers start collapsing. And it was at that point they said, could this be a terrorist attack? Could it be Muslim inspired?
Yeah.
And I thought, subhanAllah, you have no evidence, and yet you're speaking about this now. And there's me, the only Muslim in a thobe in my whole division.
Right.
So I remember, like, it's time to go. I started going home. I went to the underground to get the tube home, the train home. And I did a U-turn. And I'll tell you why I did a U-turn, Khalid, because it was nearly Maghrib. And I said to myself, will I make it to Brixton alive? I actually thought that because I saw the hatred of the people start looking for a scapegoat. So I went back and prayed Maghrib.
Yeah.
I'd already contacted my Shura and said, we need to meet at Brixton. We need to talk about what's going on. What are we going to do? Keep the community safe. And so I did pray, got on the underground. Tensions were high. You could see individuals looking at me. You could see what was going on in their minds and everything. I think they were very wary that, oh, he doesn't look like a pushover. We're not going to attack. Nothing was said. So moving from that now, the first thing we did is we're going to speak to some of the scholars. We need to get advice on how we're going to approach this. We need to make stances. I've contacted the leader of the local council and told him that this is not from the Muslims.
Yeah.
If it is from the Muslims, we are not. We don't condone it in shape or form. And he made a public announcement saying the Muslims stand in solidarity with us and everything like that. This is part of the community engagement that's necessary. Unfortunately, Muslims, Salafi and others don't feel this is something that should be done. There should be no engagement with wider community whatsoever. And this is problematic for us as much as them.
Yeah.
So what happened from that particular point on, one of our brothers, he's passed away since then, Rahim Allah, he was already scheduled to travel to Jordan. And he traveled to Jordan after a few days. We asked him to get advice from the Jordanian Mashaykh. They gave some very, very good advice. We asked individuals we know who are now cult members, unfortunately, can they speak to Sheikh Al-Banna in Jeddah, which they did, and gave us a nice fatwa. And we read that out and put it onto the wall on how we should conduct ourselves. This individual who is now a cult individual will go down to see Sheikh Rabi' in Makkah, get some advice from him. So we were already equipped with knowing what to say in the sense that we spoke, if this is from the Muslims, as I said in my very first khutbah, and I'll come back to that, if this is from the Muslims, then this is, I gave a distinction between the Khariji ideology and Ahl Sunnah. That was one of my first actual khutbahs. And so we wanted to make that distinction. And we were the only voice, Khalid. I'm still, others will say today, if you were to search, those first 2-3 weeks following 9/11, Brixton Mosque was the only one speaking openly about extremism, but not just extremism if it was the Muslims and the Khawarij ideology, but against government. And one of the things I said, as a non-Muslim said to me that I knew from my old school as I was coming out of Brixton Underground that day to give the khutbah, he said to me, the bully has got a bloody nose. This is what he said about America. And I used that in my khutbah. So we, one of the things with us as Salafis, we are always seeking the mizan, what is in the middle. So while we may criticize fellow co-religionists who may be extreme, like the Kharijites, we will also criticize government, state apparatus, state legislated terrorism. We won't lean on one side, we won't lean on the other side. And we're not given enough respect, I think, for being in that balance. And I suppose some of it is because on occasions we will say we need to engage with the authorities on equal terms, not spying and slanderous accusations that they're making and informing and everything like this, because spying goes against what the ayat says in Surah Hujurat. And we are with the ayat in Surah Hujurat. But because individuals are in this vulture culture, are always looking to capture something that you've said out of context or whatever, they want to, oh no, the Salafis, they're in the pockets of the Saudis before 9/11. After 9/11, they're in the pockets of the governments, the Western government.
Right.
And then you've got on the other side, those who will keep silent and be complicit in agreeing with almost takfiri ideology about what should be done to enact violence and instability within one's own societies.
Yeah.
And as Salafis, as Muslims, we should be ummat and wasat. And as Salafis, we need to be balanced in that instance as well. So 9/11, I think, transformed and changed many of our lives, especially when individuals, for example, that we knew, who I'd expelled from the masjid, shoe bomber Richard Reed, 20th 9/11 individual bomber, Zacharias Massawi. Beforehand, we'd expelled Abdul Al-Faisal during Abu Sufyan's time. He'd been expelled from the masjid. Abu Qatada, the first day he came into the country and visited us at Brixton with Faisal And we had Sheikh Bilal Phillips, Abu Amin and Bilal Phillips with us. And when I saw the look on Abu Amina's face when he came in his private meeting and he didn't want to translate to us what Abu Qatada had said. Abu Muntaz was there as well. After Abu Qatada had gone with these takfiri cohorts, he then told us, this man is very dangerous. And I could see alarm on Abu Amin's face because of the things that Abu Qatada had said. So we didn't know what he said. We knew that he was takfiri. We'd heard from the Jordanians concerning him. And so our campaign of warning against the ideology of extremism continued. Now, I want to give a big clarification here. And if anyone wants to edit and use this excerpt, they can.
Right.
So when speaking to the world media, we said, the police know. They already are aware of this. We've told them. What I was referring to is that they were very aware of our sermons and our khutbahs and everything like this, and our warning of ideologies. And that's what I was speaking of and speaking about. And other interviews clarified that, because I was asked, why didn't you report to the authorities? I said, report what to the authorities? They already knew. Okay, they knew the ideologies of the individuals. Our sermons are there, are public. We don't need to name, and we don't go naming individuals. Oh, let me tell you about such and such. He has a Khariji ideology. Anyone going and revealing that to the authorities, then that is informing. Because freedom of thought and speech is something that is sacrosanct in Western society. So that's not what was done either. As Brixton Mosque does today, as it's done yesteryear, we will distinguish between the haq and the batil. This is what I was speaking to and continue to speak to, mashallah. So going through the 2000s, one of the interesting things, Khalid, maybe 10 years later, is that some of those critics came to me, and I won't name them here. They know who they are. Some very public figures, some of them ex-takfiris, leading voices in takfir. And they came and they said to me, I met some of them, and they said, and I, wallahi, I swear by Allah on this, because some might say, oh, he's just making this up. And they said, no, we know that you didn't inform. We know you. I said, so why did you say that? I said, that's the only thing we could hurt you with, because
Subhanallah.
Your argument from Deen, your argument from Deen, we couldn't argue against, because it was that of the haq from the scholars. But this was a tactic to hurt us and all of my colleagues who were from the street were like, nah, how can you call us that? You know our backgrounds. This is not what we do. But, and that's still prevalent today amongst those who've just taken that narrative from others and they slander Brixton, they slander myself. I'm quite relaxed about that, because Yawm al-Qiyamah is going to be a day, if they're not going to realize the erroneous and slanderous statements today, they will realize it on that day. The fact that some of their ex-leaders have come back and those who influenced them saying, no, we know that wasn't true. We know it was a slander. Even some of them, when we had a confrontation, and I will not mention the individual's name, he's from Lewisham, knew him very well. We met in a neutral spot. And actually, no, because we are upon clarity and I'm not shy to speak, I will mention some names. When we met with Shaquille Beg, who I'd known for many years beforehand.
He studied in Yemen.
He was in Medina for a while, mashallah. And he's an imam now. And he's they see him as more or less mainstream in some instances. And I'd heard about the slanders that he'd been saying concerning myself. Abdul had told me, our children went to the same school that I mentioned my daughter first went to. He said that he'd informed on Abu Qatada and Abu Hamza. So we met, and it's quite a tense meeting. We met in Crystal Palace. Some of my colleagues were there. My brothers were there. His brothers were there. It was tense. You can imagine some, I think, came equipped as we did.
Yeah, you're right.
We were sitting in a cafeteria. And all I did is I said, we've never had that discussion. And I pulled out my phone, dialed my international number and said, I'm calling my wives and my 16 kids. Let's do Mubahala. I dial in the number. I said, get your phone out. He was sitting opposite me. Get your phone out. Hand started shaking. He won't take his phone out. His colleagues who were sitting with him were looking at him. I said, take your phone out. Call your family. Let's invoke the curse of Allah upon. And so he wouldn't take it. His hands are shaking. His colleagues said to me, Abdahat, stop. And they looked at him, amazed. Yeah. And he said, no, that's right. You didn't say that. You've never said that. You've never said that. So I said, so why did you say that? No, he said, I was wrong. I shouldn't have said that. You didn't say that. I apologize. And I saw the anger on his colleagues' faces. One of them I knew, he used to come to Brixton. I saw the anger on their face and surprise that you've been pushing this narrative for so long.
Yeah.
And now we're seeing that it was a lie. You've been giving this in sermons. You've been speaking to, and the Lewisham community, similar to the Brixton community, if they were to kick off against each other, there will be casualties, literally, because of the makeup of each community.
Right, right.
You know? So that's another example of the mischief that is there from individuals who speak very loosely, who speak to a base because they want to slander, malign, and cause doubt. And as we know, now, as you know, you've got Abu Hamza serving life sentence in America.
Yeah.
And as he...
Faisal as well, is what I heard, yeah.
Yes. I don't know if Faisal's been transferred or whatever yet, but Abu Hamza produced 50 pages. His lawyer produced 50 pages of evidence to show that he'd been working with the police in the late 90s. You just have to look it up on Google.
Yeah.
He said, yeah, I was working with the police. They wanted me to keep the peace on the ground and everything. So he's calling others informer and living off that. Where in actuality, he's reporting to the police. He's giving them intelligence. They're speaking to him. There's another individual that used to be beside him, Al-Siri, Yasser Al-Siri, who left the country. Who was? These are things that were happening.
Yeah,
and
you find that a lot from those tech fiddies. You find that they flip the script. Leave Islam. Exactly. Morton Storm is a classic example.
Morton Storm, yes. And even Morton Storm himself, when he said, when he was now turned into an informer and he visited the UK, he went to a study circle of Abu Hamza and he came back and said, yes, I saw he was an informer as well. And I confirmed that I know he's an informer as well. So this is the thing, but you see a silence now from the Takfiris.
Yeah.
Where are they going to speak against their own now that this is done? This shows that they are unjust.
Yeah.
Not only in their manhaj and in their ideology, but in their mu'amalat, in how they deal with things. There's a sense of injustice there. Sadly, when we look within the closer circles, smaller circles of Salafia, you'll see that similar behavior, that behavioral extremism, which isn't the same as ideological extremism, as you know from my PhD.
Right.
Behavioral extremism, which is subjective, you'll see that amongst cult members. As you know, I refer to them as the Abu Khadija. It's a Salafi publication. Right. Oh, you know, I'm not shy to speak. I hope that's not causing you any problems with me speaking openly in this way.
No. I want you to, this is unleashed.
No, mashallah. So that's a similar behavior and a similar parallel to the Takfiris. It's one step removed in that their dawah is to themselves and they believe they are the only Salafis. And one of the reasons we see this, Khalid, any talented individual who's graduated or studied and is articulate and has the respect of the scholars, if he or she does not embrace or engage with the cult, they go upon, they embark upon a campaign of disparagement. Look at Sheikh Tahir White. Look at Mohammed Mufti Munir. Look at Sheikh Abu Usama. Let's look before that at Dr. Abu Amina Bilal Phillips. Let's look before that at Sheikh Suhaib Hassan. And I will mention Sheikh Suhaib Hassan. Why? Because I heard when I sat in Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abad's home in 2003, him referencing Sheikh Suhaib. And one of the cult members who graduated from Medina at the time was in that sitting. And he tried to say something disparaging about Sheikh Suhaib. Or cast out on him when Sheikh Abdul Muhsin had said, refer to him, he's the scholar in the UK. And he shut him down immediately. Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Abad shut this individual down immediately. I won't mention the individual's name because he hasn't put himself out there like that. He's one of the quiet ones in Jeddah, but he weaves his web according to their instructions. But that happened then. Also, we know that Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, was the one who'd instructed Sheikh Suhaib first to go to Africa, and then to go to the UK. So when you've got such endorsement, and when Sheikh Suhaib used to come over for Hajj, Sheikh bin Baz, when he was visiting Makkah, would make a beeline to the hotel or the camp where Sheikh Suhaib was. But yet we have upstarts disparaging and bringing down the repute of someone who Akibar endorsed. And that statement that became prevalent amongst some of their scholars, our scholars as well, if you like, that we know their hal and their situation better than the kibar and such like.
Yeah.
I'm bringing that because that's something they started using. Okay, saw this problem with them from years before. Then my question would be, well, you were with Sheikh Mohammed bin Hadi for 20 years. So how come you didn't see any problems or issues that you're ascribing now to Sheikh Mohammed bin Hadi? And this is not in defense of Sheikh Mohammed bin Hadi, but it shows the double standard there that all of them in this mess, this little circle of mess that they're in, are involved and entangled with. That it's almost a cannibalism that's taking place amongst them, because the principles that they say they're adhering to, we realize are not principles when it comes to them being applied to themselves. Such is the contradiction and sense of denialism amongst the cult and its cult followers, which is very unfortunate. And I continually refer to the cult because the damage that they've caused amongst Salafis in the West are unparalleled. They are unparalleled. And when I did the night shift with our brothers a few years ago, one of the things I likened this to, what they've done in some of the Salafi communities, was an ideological equivalent to the destruction that was wrought by crack when it was introduced into the black communities.
SubhanAllah.
Because you had, for example, I'm aware of how the Nation of Islam was predominant in America amongst the older generations.
Right.
And then, alhamdulillah, they came away from that. Some went with Waris D. Muhammad, and he'd broken away from his father. But then you had a contingent that recognized Salafiyah, came upon Salafiyah. We had Abu Muslimah and individuals like that moving forward, Dawud Adib and the others. Whatever mistakes or faults are there, may Allah forgive them for them. But they were not on a methodology as corrupted as this cult is are now. And they were not on a methodology of division and destruction. This cult has not built anything except their own empire. There are no communities that are built, actual communities that are built in the same way that we saw communities being built by Brixton, by other American communities in that instance there. Yet they may say we've got these satellites around the country. You only have to look at these satellites and see the deference they give to Abu Khadija, the financial supplies that they're giving in that particular direction as well. They are the Muslim equivalent on a microcosmic scale to the Nation of Islam. Nation of Islam weren't Muslim. We have no doubt about that. But in Islam, within the people of Sunnah, this cult are that equivalent. They are that equivalent. I have no doubt about that. And I want to paint a picture on why I draw those parallels.
Yeah, please do, because you pulled out your sword, doctor. Yeah, listen, hear why you're sharpening it.
Inshallah, inshallah. So, for example, we look and we see with Nation of Islam, they had at the top Fard Muhammad, okay? This mystical figure that only Elijah Muhammad, who called himself a messenger, had that access to. Now, I want to be very careful when I draw the parallels now. At that level, you've got those equating Sheikh Rabi', Hafidahullah, okay, our Sheikh. Now, I'm not putting him on the figure of deity. I'm putting him on that being removed from those who can access him, okay? Then when you come down with the Nation of Islam now, you have Elijah Muhammad, okay? This voice, I spoke to the messenger, I'm the messenger, and he gave all the guidance and he built the empire and everyone was giving deference. He had his foot soldiers, including Malcolm X at one particular time. You come down from Sheikh Rabi' within a Western context now, you have Abu Khadija, Abdul Wahid Alam, the head of the Abu Khadijites. I won't say madcalism because that's an insult and it's a derogatory term, and I don't accept that term. Abu Khadija, when he emerged in 96, around that time, this is when the beginning of the end of the unity that we were trying to maintain after the demise of Jimas began, okay? Because Abu Hakim, Yusuf Bowers, Abu Talha, who left them, as you know, before he died, rahimahullah, we were all together. When Abu Khadija came into the mix, is when this, and his cousin, Amjad Rafiq, is when the disintegration started to take place. Amjad Rafiq came in a few years earlier. He was at Essex University. They used to call him Maududi, and he came in amongst the Jimas lot. Abu Khadija was not Salafi in the early 90s. Let's be very clear on that. He was on a Hadi vibe. His name, Abu Khadija, his wife, Khadija. Khadija, his ex-wife, comes from Bosnia. I'm not saying that everyone who went to Bosnia was on a jihadi thing. I went to Bosnia, we did leaf work and everything like that. But Abu Khadija's revisionist narrative, as with Yusuf Bowers, as with Abu Iyad, that they were upon, the manhaj wasn't really being taught and there wasn't real Salafiyah until after 1996.
Mm.
It is just that, revisionism, and it is a lie. So coming back to the parallels that I'm drawing. So then you've got Abu Khadija, this charismatic personality, the head of the Abu Khadijahs, everyone giving deference. You can hear them say, and like they say, the honorable, so-called the honorable Elijah Muhammad. Mm. Now you're seeing, for that's from the Nation of Islam. Now you'll see within the Salafi publications cult, the Abu Khadijahs, they spoke against Abu Khadija, our noble brothers, our noble elder, Sheikh. They're being called Sheikh now, as you know. When you listen to the followers, the same accolade and reverence and deference that was being given to Elijah Muhammad by that cult, the same is happening with this cult and Abu Khadija. And he's got those around him, Abu Hakim, Hassan Somali, and Musa Richardson, and these others. And the reason that they're there is because they can taste off the same plate of revenue and benefits, status and everything that he's allowing them or affording them, and it's basically there it's a mutual benefit that they've actually got there. So when you come down and you look at the blindness and the level of denialism amongst the followers, and you look at the language of them, you just have to go onto the website. Anyone who speaks against Abu Khadija, look at what the followers say. May Allah break his back. May all this vitriol that comes from them, and they will quote from the Salaf. But it's all vitriol. There isn't that critical thinking and saying, okay, these opponents have a point. Let's speak about these points. Let's engage in a respectful manner. No, it's abuse after abuse after abuse. But let me say one thing, Khalid.
Yeah.
They can only do that verbally, the majority of them, especially the leadership, because I will say again, and I call them out on it, and I'm saying it to you now again, because they are cowards. There's a degree of cowardice amongst them, just like we saw with Jim Jones, the George Guyana tragedy, and bringing that, like we saw with Waco. Cults have particular traits. Their followers have particular traits, and I'm going to bring my cognitive development framework from my PhD now, and I won't keep you much longer. There are four stages, as you know. You, mashallah, you referenced it in your PhD. Cults keep their followers at the first two rudimentary stages of idealism, the founding stage and the youthful stage, and they never move them beyond that because they want them to have a dependency upon them. However, those who are within Salafiyah or within the religious groupings that they're in and really growing and learning and accessing the scholars, they're able to proceed to the adult phase, which is reflective and actualized, and the mature phase. They're able to move from those two early rudimentary stages, which you should be able to move away from in cognitive development and progress, but cults keep them there. And you may say, someone may say, but they've got graduates from Medina and those who have studied with them. Then we then have to look at the psychological makeup of those individuals who've always been in need of an organization or a grouping, groupthink, a sense of belonging. And because of that sense of belonging and that recognition that they're given by the leadership, they're happy to stay at those rudimentary stages because they've got that sense of belonging and ownership from cult leadership. That's why you see some graduates among them. That's why you see some professionals among them, because they have this very simplistic and rudimentary need and this fear of independence and autonomy. This is why they stay at those particular stages. Those who don't are a threat to the cult. Hence the problems the cult are experiencing now by individuals converging from elsewhere and speaking concerning them. And my last cultist tendencies, which I've just done very recently, cultist tendencies 14, part 1 and 2. But when you look at my Chronicles of UK Salafism, which I've now completed, that's 30 years, every year from 1990 up to 2019. And in the final one that I've done, the 2019, I bring my own typology now. We know that Quinton Ritorovic and all these other academics brought typology of Salafiyah, saying it's of three categories, Salafi quietism, Salafi
Qadi emphasizes that
That's right. We know that that's inaccurate because the two others that they bring are the Ikhwani Muslimin ideology and the Takfiri ideology. I've brought my own typology, which focuses on constituencies. And I know you'd be interested in. So after looking at the 30 years and looking at the UK landscape, I've said that first criteria would be the local insular Salafi communities that are convert based, but wider community engaged, like Britain. Then I bring a second constituent and categorization. Again, insular, but more culturally community-based and engaging with, like we see with the Green Lane, predominantly South Asian community, Green Lane Mosque, predominantly South Asian community in that instance there. So those are two, one's more convert-led and engaging with wider society. The other one is more culturally led and engaging with the wider South Asian community in Birmingham, because it's a bigger Muslim populace. Then we move to the third categorization, classification. And that's the most divisive, destructive, and reprehensible of those amongst the Salafi constituencies. That's none other than the cult, the Abu Khadijite cult. And I'm not going to elaborate upon that because I've been speaking about them intermittently as we've discussed during this podcast. The fourth criteria, which I think is a refreshing development, is those Salafis, second, third generation, and established Salafis like ourselves, who are now, with a small s, who are amongst the mainstream populace of Muslims. And that's the biggest groundswell. It's not the community-based ones that I've just mentioned. It's the bigger groundswell, and that's of established Muslims at the third and fourth stages. They've grown, they've developed, they've actualized their Islam. And it's the second and third generation who, because of the influence of Salafia and our literature and our books and the scholars, that they reference authentic material now. They subscribe to the first three generations loosely according to the classification that and description that Sheikh Ali Hassan had given about Salafia. And that fourth category is the one that is growing more and more predominant. Unafraid to be independent and access scholars directly themselves, unafraid and of these groups, and especially the third one that I've mentioned to you, that if we're not belonging to a group or affiliated to a masjid, that we're going to be chastised and we're not going to be Salafi. So that fourth group, in my estimation, is a good group to develop and be amongst, mashallah tabarakallah. And when you look at their stages of development, and I'll conclude on this, when you look at their stages of development, the first constituency, the convert-led constituency, if they continue to have that blind deference that we cannot move forward in anything socio-culturally, socio-politically, and socio-religiously, socio-religiously not so much because we need to be attached to our scholars, but if they cannot move forward in that instance and they're always waiting for scholars to come back, then they will remain at the first two stages of my cognitive framework. Likewise for the second category. The third category we've already mentioned, the cult, they're at the first, if not second stage, and they keep themselves there. But the fourth category, the new ones will come through the stages one and two, but the older, more established ones are at stages three and four. So they're all at different stages of my cognitive development framework, but those are the four constituencies I would proffer as a typology from an insider perspective, and I'll stop there.
Jazakallah khair, Allah yubarak fik. You have given us a breadth of knowledge, a breadth of perspectives, so much to say. My time is definitely running short, but I wanna end with this because it went a little bit in a different direction than I intended, but alhamdulillah, this was your forum, and jazakallah khairan for the definitely knowledge-based analytical framework that you've given and offered, and historical, you know, we could just go on and on. Anyhow, what I want to say is, because you've opened those doors, let me ask you, because I have my own thoughts about some of these issues. Firstly, why do you think it's valuable to, I mean, you spent a lot of energy attacking what you refer to as the Abu Khadijites and the cults, and I see this, that there's a major backlash against those guys. What I fear with putting all this energy and emphasis, and what I see a lot of people really going hard in the paint against these guys, I fear that for one, that it takes away from Salafism. Not that they are the representatives of Salafism, but there's a lot of people who come out of the woodworks to capitalize on this and say, hey, See, we told you Salafia is false. You know, there's, what's the guy in the UK who's a professor, the Sufi, maybe in...
Tim Winter, you're saying, Tim, Abu Murad.
Yes. I've seen some of his statements, and I actually quoted some of his statements, and he was just like, you know, alhamdulillah, this is the demise finally of Salafism, and then real traditional Islam can go forward. You know, I've seen some of his statements when he was talking about the reforms in Saudi Arabia and things like this. So what I fear is that you have a lot of the people of falsehood and innovation. You know, this is the kind of stuff Yasser Qadhi is rejoicing, you know, because he'll say, this is what I've been saying, and this is my Salafism matters, you know, to talk about the splits and so forth. Obviously, I know your position, and I've read, and I wouldn't have you on here if I didn't know who you are and your perspectives and so forth. But what I fear is, with putting all that energy, you know, we're letting Hamza Yusuf skate away and continue his reign, and you know, just all of these other Hizbi groups, and they unite together to attack Ahl Sunnah. So, you know, I feel it feeds them, and these people, regardless of whatever our various perspectives on Salafi publications and so forth, I feel to a degree that they are closer to us than some of these other groups. Mm. So what would you say about maybe that, those criticisms and those
very excellent point. Excellent point, Khalid.
Yeah.
That has been the narrative for 20 years now.
Okay.
And I remember sitting with Sheikh Rabih in his home on a number of occasions, and he saw me getting upset. And he, after he said, Jazakallah khair, Brixton, for being patient, you've taken my instruction not to speak out against them, Jazakallah khair. Yeah. And I got annoyed. I said, Sheikh, why do you keep telling us to keep quiet, but you're giving them, they don't seem to be keeping quiet, and they go away with whatever you've said, and they distort and everything like that.
Right.
So from that time, the noughties, from when I came to Saudi Arabia in 2002 and visiting Sheikh Rabih privately, mashallah, with Sheikh Mohammed Maliki and others would be coming, and he'd invite me, and I'd sit and have dinner with the Sheikh, mashallah, tabarakallah, and I'd keep bringing these issues here because he saw clearly there was this issue. But we've not seen any improvement. And the narrative that you're saying from Hamza Yusuf, Tim Winter, Abu Hakim Murad and everything, they've been like that from the beginning. They're against Salafia Abada. Okay.
Yeah.
But if we are not going to be internally critical of those who have been causing destruction from amongst our ranks, that rot is going to be perceived across all of us.
Yeah.
And that's what's actually taking place. So when you've got Salafis saying this is not the correct Salafia, that's part of the narrative.
Yeah.
And then I'll add, in the body of work that I've done, as you know, there's the 30 episodes that I've done of the Chronicles of UK Salafism, which is not a refutation on the cult. It's to give archives and annals of history about Salafia. Sufis haven't even done that. Actually, nobody's done that. So the body of work that we're putting out, this is just a sideline to say, be aware. And Khalid, the effects are happening. The individuals who have come to me from Australia, from America, from around, and other Salafi brothers, ex-cult members who I'm in my WhatsApp groups with as well, and were sharing things. I've had the trauma that some of them are going through and what they're sharing from what they've had at the cult, with the cult. This is necessary because there are individuals who are not only leaving Salafia and the cult, they're leaving Deen. Now, some will say, Qadrallah, mashallah, that happens with all denominations and the like. Of course it does. But to remain silent about those who are closer to you. So, for example, you and me, we may have brothers who are Muslim, blood brothers who are Muslim. And they may be doing things that are disagreeable, publicly or otherwise. Do we ignore them and rectification with them? Because others might say, ah, the Khalid Green family is bad, or the Abdahat Baker family is bad? Or do we clarify and others know we are rectifying and getting our own house in order?
No.
One of the reasons why I did the PhD that I did, to say I'm going to look at our reality from within, and I'm going to be self-analytical and self-critical from within. And irrespective of whether we are exposing and speaking to these against these Salafis and or not, the narrative of Hamza Yusuf, Yasser Qadhi, Tim Winter, Abdul Hakim Murad, it's going to be there regardless.
Yeah, of course.
So what we need to do is show we are aware of this group in plain sight. We criticize, we disparage them. And over here, this is what Salafia looks like. And this is what is happening. And you're seeing the work of, again, Sheikh Tahir White. You're seeing the work of Salafis like yourself. And that is what the focus is about, the balance, about what Salafia is about. So for me, that's a necessary component that needs to be done. But for example, if others came clearly, like some would say that those in the UK, Mohammed Hijab and others, and they're trying to say, oh, they're against Salafia and such and such. Some of us have spoken to them at length privately, and I've advised him privately, even when he's done things that were incorrect, and he's retracted publicly and pulled them down. And if we can have that sort of influence on these individuals to say, whoa, if you're doing that, do you know you're speaking at Salafia? You know we're Salafia. And we're not saying we're all doing ta'awun, but at least they're saying, okay, is this too much? Yes, it's too much, because this is not Salafia.
Yeah.
And if you're going to be talking against this group, you need to promote and highlight what Salafia actually is in that instance. Whether they're Salafi or not. The fact that we've got that narrative amongst some in the mainstream, whether they're Salafi or not, is very important. In contrast to the cult, who only speak to each other and chastise everybody else. So I hope that's addressing your question. Again, whether we do this or not, the methodology of these individuals that you've mentioned, they will be disparaging Salafia regardless, because they are against the haq. They've said that, they've shown that throughout the last 30 years.
Subhanallah. Very strong perspective and very beneficial. I think probably myself, just in to add on to it, I would just say there's probably a difference in maybe methodology for approaching the problem. Maybe some definitions, but so this is very, very enlightening. Jazakallah khair. Last point before we close out. What do you advise the youth that are out there? We've got our youth. We know we're losing our youth in the streets. We know there's a lot of youth that are confused. They're confused about this even, because one of the reasons why, for me, for example, why I don't a lot of times go into detail about individuals, unless I feel it's necessary, as some of our mashayikh do, is because a lot of people don't know how to handle, they don't listen. People are going to listen to this, and they're going to draw their own conclusions, come up with things you didn't even say, and they're going to already build and say, oh, he said this, and Khalid Green allowed this, and he said this. You know, people... Right. They hear what they want. A lot of people are not mature enough. They're maybe not intellectually, on that level to be, to intellectually astute, to be able to comprehend even some of these discussions. So what they throw out the baby with the bathwater. So what would you say in general for the youth seeking the truth, you know, that may get shook up off their pedestal because they don't know, they don't have the tools. They just listen to certain people. You know, and then there's other youth who are just, we're not even reaching at all because they're in the street, they're in gangs, our girls are doing everything under the sun. What was your advice in you being
fantastic? First, I would say to those who are listening, what you and me have discussed, and when I've highlighted this aspect of the cult, I've highlighted this aspect because we've never discussed it before, Masha Tabarakallah. This is a very small but significant element that needs to be addressed occasionally. And I would invite others to go and look on my website, and they say, well, hold on, Yadi talks about this on his website, because they're not that much of an issue, but they're significant enough because one bad apple spoils the lot, as you know.
No.
So you need to isolate that and then keep it moving. What I would also say is we need to make sure that we're instilling and inculcating in our youth that they have dual identities and even more multifaceted identities. What I've seen with this whole George Floyd thing is this diminishing narrative from Salafis as well, that, Black Lives Matter, you can't speak about Black Lives Matter. No, the organization, the movement, we must speak against. And I say that immediately when speaking. Black Lives Matter, the cause, it's almost as though becoming Muslim, Sunni, Salafi, our minds have become Arabized, okay? And there's no cultural connectivity with where we're from. And our youth see that. Our youth see that and they cannot relate to that.
Right.
And our sense of religiosity is you've got to look like you are from somewhere in the Middle East. Mm. And I, many of us did that.
Yeah.
Okay. And take on the vernacular from the Middle East.
Mm.
And actually, that's not the reality.
Of course.
Because Islam did not come to Arabize cultures.
Mm-hmm.
It came to enhance the permissible aspects of cultures, and the others that are less permissible, are not permissible, impermissible, should be shunned. Mm. So our youth need to have a sense of identity and identifiability.
No.
We don't speak about black excellence because then there's the accusation of nationalism. And as you can see, I did the series, and I'm still doing it, on To the Moon and Black, where I'm speaking about the environments that we live in, structural racism, systemic racism. I'm talking about the racism we face as Muslims from the more predominant communities, the South Asians and the Arabs. And I'm talking about a sense of black excellence, looking at our history, because as we know, our history did not start with slavery. It was interrupted by it.
Yes.
Our history predates slavery. The first Muslim civilization outside of Arabia was Africa, Abyssinia. A great kingdom that took in the first immigrants in that instance.
No.
These things are not spoken about. We're the tokenistic references to Bilal. We need to extend beyond that. Bilal was part of that great, he descended from that Abyssinian heritage from via his mother's lineage and everything.
Yes.
So this needs to be taught, and a sense of pride and belonging needs to be instilled in our youth who are on the street. They need to have a relatability with the faith that is there, not look at us as elders and see Arabization. They need to see these are black African-American, black British Muslims, proud of their identity, and but they've been enhanced because they're Muslims, because they're on the Sunnah. Because we see that amongst the other communities, the South Asians, the Arabs, we see that amongst them. Why not amongst us as Western black people? Why has there got to be that Arab, that Arabized perspective that is there?
Yeah.
Why? And some will come back and say, oh, how can he say this? This is wrong. Da, 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 da.
Yeah.
Then I say, we are in a sense of denialism that needs to, that those shackles need to be removed. We didn't come from being duped and oppressed by a white racist systemic system to now jump into the fire of Arabization, South Asian culture. And I'm not frowning upon these cultures. What I'm saying is that we don't eschew one to adopt another.
Yeah.
We need to have an understanding of self within the wide parameters that this beautiful deen allows. Surah Hujurat made you into tribes and nations so that you may know each other.
No, jazakallah khair, Allah yubarakfik. Okay, last point, as we mentioned, طيب, so what do you give to the advice to those youngsters that are, they're out in the streets, if they'll even hear this, you know, maybe someone will share with some of these youngsters, because our youth are far well, they're not in the masjid, they don't want to hear this, they don't have a sense of identity, their identity is in the gang, it's in the girls, their identity is karamakum Allah, is a sex symbol. This is, I mean, there's a lot of Muslim girls that are, that's what they do. That's their YouTube pages. That's their Facebook, their social media. Their outlet is that. And they are just, Islam is going by the wayside. What do you give to the, what do you offer as a quick piece of advice to those?
I would say to them, in short, they should remember, I think one of the paraphrasing what one of the Salaf said, that intoxication with life is, intoxication with alcohol is a better calamity to be in than intoxication with life. Because with intoxication with alcohol, and I'm not saying it's permissible at all, I'm giving a contrast. Yeah. The intoxication with alcohol, you've got the opportunity to wake up the next morning with a hangover, headache, and have regret and remorse, oh, I will never do this again.
Mm.
However, with intoxication with life, the time you wake up for sobering is when you wake up, in your grave to Munkar and Nakir.
SubhanAllah.
And when you've woken up to them, as we know, nafsi, nafsi, there is no going back. So for the Muslim woman who's demeaning herself, you are the best and purest of women, and yet you're defiling yourself on social media, and worse, physically, you have to look at what message you are saying about Islam. And Muslims who slip in the way you have slipped. The men who are doing the gangbanging and violating women and men and all of this as well, they need to think about this as well. because they have to say to themselves, is this the lack of worth that I have obtained from my religious upbringing, from my understanding of the deen? Am I just a Ramadan Muslim or a Friday prayer Muslim? Is this what my parents and what the deen has placed upon me? And again, if that's the case, then wait till you become sober with life. Wait till the sobering aspects of life hit you, because at that point, it's too late.
SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah. Jazakallah khairan, Doctor. Allah yubarak fikum.
Yeah.
You've shared a wealth of your experience and your knowledge, your wisdom and your insight, and we just say Jazakallah khairan, and we hope in the future that we'll have these some other times to sit and expound on various topics, inshallah ta'ala.
Inshallah. Jazakallah khair, Khalid, for having me. Honored to be here and being here with you. Jazakallah khair.
Jazakallah khairan, Doctor. Hayyakum Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.